Item 14, 15, the future management development of Meadows Country Park. Mike, are you going to introduce this?
Yes, thanks, Chair. Chair, with your agreement, in a moment I'd like to invite Ben Johnston from Property Services to take us through the designs which we've been seeing perhaps on the screen just now, to summarise what's happening proposed in relation to the investments in the local Meadows. I think that would be helpful to the committee, so your agreement. In terms of just the introducing the report, just a few words from myself, but the background to this is set out in the report. The background, this goes back some time to the longer term development plan for Lochore Meadows, and within that there's always been a priority to look at the visitor centre and to look at the golf clubhouse. It's quite important to stress that the work that's gone on both through the Fife Countryside Trust, through the council and prior work has always been about the totality of investment in the area. It's never been solely about the visitor centre, it's always been about the juxtaposition of investments and how they support the development of the park going forward. And the key enabling investments made by the council are summarised in the report. There was £1 million within in the 1417 budget, that same budget put £150,000 in for development of the sport pavilion in the adjacent Dorothy Fifth Park. And in the subsequent 16-19 budget, a further £300,000 allocated in that, including the enabling funding for this. The intention was that the investments would be taken forward by the Countryside Trust, partly because they were managing agent, but still are managing agent for the Lochore Meadows, but also because it was felt that to leverage some external funding for the project. Section 2 of the report just gives a very straightforward, factual picture of the journey of this office to the point we're at today. I'm not going to go through that. I will say a couple of remarks about it. Key points within it are the fact that during 2015 it became apparent that hope for external funding will not in fact transpiring. So that then would be the necessity of a rethink in terms of what's possible. Property Services and the Council were invited to look at possibilities for that. They came up with a modular design which had been tried and tested previously in the National City. There was general and broad support for that through the FCCT and also through the advisory board at the time. There was subsequent agreement to those designs back in this time last year, and really the designs that you've actually seen at the moment have not changed since then. They were subsequently endorsed by the Golf Trust and the Fife Countryside Trust in April, and committed to us, and that then led to the filing and consultation period, which is then. When looking at that, what I'm setting out is just the factual position, what happened in relation to the planning consultation set out in paragraph 11. It is worth making the point that although it is the fact that nobody came back to us and there were no representations made on the designs, nonetheless, it is the case that at least two of the community councils have said they didn't receive the retailers for that paper. All I can say about that is they were sent out. And I can't really short of comment on that further. I think it's fair to say also that in relation to the consultation process, because there has been comment about the consultation process, that the Fife Countryside Board have accepted and it's safe to be at the advisory board, but on reflection there should have been more meetings of the advisory board through 2016. Having said that, the designs were agreed again by the advisory board early in December, and as I said, the previous agreed in January of the same year. The final part of the report really touches on some risks. But obviously, the committee will be reminded to take a different course of action than is suggested by the recommendation. All I'm saying in that part of the report is there are risks you need to be mindful of if that were to be the case. Some of those risks we can control. We can control whether or not, in that scenario, the visitor centre would be reopened. Some of those are out of our control. If we go to the revised tender, there is the possibility, the potential risk of increased costs. There is a situation with Sport Scotland funded, which is at risk. We circulated the letter from the Scottish Government to that plan review, in which I think confirms the position in relation to the fund. It is at risk. We we will try and make sure that doesn't happen, but nonetheless, I have to tell you that it is a risk. Finally, there are risks which I believe to be inevitable in terms of cost. A re-tendering exercise would cost more. This cost of quality in some design terms. And obviously, if the ambition were to do something different, then that design would need to cost up in terms of what that might mean, and that might mean for the cost of the So that basically the background. As I said, I now invite Raymond just to maybe go through the designs so that members can get a feel for what was actually proposed visually.
Thanks, Mike. Just a quick introduction. Property services were briefed to design to procure the opportunity buildings from Inbo Co. Meadows, Scottish Park, working closely with our clients, Central Trust and Broadcast. Total budget available for these projects was listed from 1 million for the visitor centre and 669,000 for the golf football pavilion. Both buildings, as you can see, are designed in-house by the same architects group that successfully delivered one opportunity camp and scale between the centre, the other high schools and numerous other high profile projects. Our architects followed due process throughout. Affordable outline scheme signed off by our clients and held
to huge.
Project is strictly cost managed throughout the design process to ensure that we deliver affordable buildings. It's very important to understand in this financial climate there is no point in architects designing schemes that are significantly over budget. What's been produced, for your information, I put a couple of our artists' impressions on the screen. These impressions are also prepared by an in-house architect. Impressions provide a useful insight into our proposals both internally and externally. As you see it running through, you can see the visitor centre and some insight to the visitor centre, also externally. So from the interactive centre will be within the visitor centre, and also the golf football ground. And external shops. There's also a photograph there. Sometimes with our Revit system, it's not very advanced now what we can actually show in these, but sometimes the colour doesn't come over exactly right, so that's a little bit of picture on exactly how we look, the client would look. There's absolutely no doubt that the proposed visitor centre is smaller than the existing, but architects have worked very hard to balance functionality, architectural vision, and the budget. Our best value on these projects. The existing facility was bigger, but 260 square metres was not accessible to the public, and 150 square metres was wasted circulation. The new visitor centre has a large modern cabinet and can be doubled in size if required. The building also has an interpretation area to reflect the history of the park. The golf football pavilion is a project that will provide two changing rooms and shower areas to sports Scotland standards. The building also has an education mode purpose room, refereeing, changing, professional golf shop and golfers' training area. The building is very much an integrated facility between football and golf as well. The construction, by councils, you know, are at the forefront of maximising the benefits of all off-site fabrication, i.e. manufacturing large components of the buildings and delivering these to site. These are huge advantages, this approach, and very much the direction of travel for the construction industry. We actually see a detailed round of how we're going to build the visitor centre. I've included a slide of the proposed construction visitor centre. It's completely untrue to suggest this building is a temporary structure. It is very much a permanent structure that is designed for over 40 to 50 years. The external walls of the building will be built off site, but the structure will be supported from a steel frame. You can see from the slide how the building was put together. The golf football pavilion will be a timber kitchen structure that again maximises everything we believe. And benefits of off-site fabrication. The building by its very nature makes it easy to extend in the future either towards the play park or the lock to us as a centre. Procurement. A number of allegations have been made against the procurement of these buildings. The answers to a procurement approach, why we secured both buildings together, value for money, other councils' costs, etc., etc., have been robustly answered by myself and we found that issue yesterday. QSEs who work in this building have over 100 years of public procurement experience on their site. I also have correspondence from Highland Council who confirm that they simply could not produce buildings for the prices quoted and have categorically backed our cost per square metre allowances. So where are we now? Our legal acceptance for the project currently set on hold to appoint a local contractor carry out these works. As explained to the narrative forum and advisory board, their options to test only the golf football pavilion and put on hold as it was sent in, but this will create additional costs for the project. Splitting the buildings will create additional preliminary costs, redesign fees, money will require to be spent on building an existing centre, and construction inflation will continue to keep the set budget. But both meetings that I've attended with the forum group and advisory group have made it very clear that more than happy to work with the community that will alleviate their concerns over the functionality and cadence of the building. We have an opportunity to both work with myself, our designers, our local contractor, and the forum to use two buildings as an asset for life.
Okay, I'm proposing to take questions first, take questions to the officers, and then put forward a recommendation. We'll go on to take questions first before we go to the debate on issues.
Thanks, Chair. There's obviously been a great deal of debate and discussion there are a great deal of questions that have been, and I believe most people have something to ask the chair. The lack of consultation, reduced size of building, the prefab, or lack of design for the new building, and it certainly appears to be an issue with the timescale for the new building. In particular, there's been a certain amount of talk about using Sports Scotland funding. The project has an allocation of 1.769 million, and yet there seems to be a concern that we will lose 82,000 from Sports Scotland, which if you listen to what has been said by some people, this can completely stop the project. My understanding is that Sports Scotland are far from threatening to move this funding and are more than happy to discuss an extension. Firstly, has my council requested a further extension of this 83,000 from Sports Scotland? The next question is, who will be looking after the media's at the public meeting on the 5th of December? There was a representative from the Five Posts and Countryside Trust who had a great deal to say about certain points, but absolutely nothing to say on whether they were going to continue running the media's, which I find strange that a mere 9 days later they removed themselves from the management of the media's. 2.4 in the report, this extension was estimated to cost 1.302 million, excluding that from Fife Council. We're responsible for 1 million of this funding, and the Fife Post and Countryside Trust were responsible for securing the balance of 342,000 from this extent of funding sources, including a failed application for the Scottish Government Regeneration Capital Grant Fund. Can you tell me when this application was made to the Scottish Government? Who made the application? How much the application was for, and what were the grounds for rejection? What cost was involved in reopening the existing research centre after the pre-demolition asbestos checks? And finally, there is a solution to this. The plan is likely to track the clubhouse and associate parking at Glen Cree, which none of the residents wanted, is put on hold the possibility of a review for this to go into the meetings instead. This would save costs and a new clubhouse and associated parking. And as I say, the savings could then be put into a bigger resource centre and fit the purpose for the meetings.
Okay, there's a number of points there. Do you want to come back on the specific questions just now?
Okay, so there's two aspects to that. So Grant comments on the funding aspect for Scotland and the financial funding and then on the
right, please. The position is £30,000 worth of active policies funding set out in the court. So I don't know if you're saying anything to report to what's being said in the letter circulating as a oversight. From the sports minister to the 30th of December. The formal position is that we're giving one extension today, and also recognise the challenge of editors trying to do in the more procurement process. The key ones we can see that we're all doing that with the change to move forward. That extension is very clear, we need to complete the project by the end of February. Now, so there is a natural resource pressure for this, and I think 3,000 about. However, we have met with Lochore on the 10th of January, the Dickinson for Airport Facilities Unit, and we have asked for some flexibility in terms of the 3,000. So there's no response from Lochore yet. They want to see where we go as of today. So the decision to the council, we will see that as well. So this is where we are. We are hopeful that maybe some flexibility then, £3,000 or so may not take, but we can't guarantee that. Reinforce the point that the position is very clear, and I see the stand right now, we are not going to be able to achieve. So there is something in this round over 3,000. I think the council may want it out, it's a small part of the project, nonetheless, beyond the issue where we can have the money. There is at this point in time no other capital frame on the table. So if there's an 8,000 pounds shortfall, that can have to be found by looking on fair being capital frame through our next year. So that's the position we have 3,000. In terms of the Scottish Regeneration Capital Fund, I need to come back on a precise date for memory, the application and decision making process of the summer reporting of 2015. The application was made by the Microscope Sun Trust. It was alongside 3 or 5 applications that the council brought forward, and one of which was to be closing sites in the UK, which was successfully going to some funding.
Can you come back to me with the reasons why it wasn't successful? Or do you not have that to hand?
I don't have that to hand. There will be feedback from the Scottish Government as to why it didn't receive funding. Fundamentally, there's a limited amount of money available for each energy and local authority. So when you put in 4 or 5 local authorities, you think that has to be ranked in priority order. That's not a good idea necessarily, so you should follow that priority order, but it's certainly not going to be able to count. And certainly, the proposed recycling facilities are higher than the other than the design centre. So there's a limit to how many projects you can actually support in 3 or so relatively small.
Beyond the perception, there's a comment back, there's a special funding requirement for happy working with the Massachusetts State Survey, pre-demolition. We do that all buildings. The opportunity when SCC can move out the building was getting there through this Massachusetts Survey. Had it been done at a demolition survey, you can imagine it is pretty. So they're trying to find every bit of space if there's any bit of space in the building. So they'll go right through doors. Also, the VTA traffic, some lighting and some heating in the area that we need to fund all that work as well. So we, our QSAs, are looking at 120 pounds of the VTA construction.
The other issue was about the management that they were putting forward.
Just build on it, but those are something I obviously have have been to the park in the past, but could somebody just clarify, we're talking about an advisory board, we're talking about forum, we're talking about community councils, could somebody just explain to me how all of these fit together? Were people who are now objected to this, were they not involved at all in this process? As, yeah, as I would have expected that they would have been. Could I also refer to Councillor Mary Lockhart's letter, which we all got yesterday? I wasn't quite sure whether Mary was going to be here today and speak to us, but she is. But she talks about, just quoting now, her perception was that an undertaking was given on behalf of Fife Council, by which I feel bound to the local councillor. So who was it who gave that undertaking? And she goes on to say, if there was not support, then the development would be halted. So could somebody clarify that for us, please?
Come back to us.
In terms of the plans, 2.11 report refers to the plans being on display in the centre and in the golf club for 4 or 5 months. Plans are also made available through the section of the United Centre that is where we have the post by Dr. Services in June. So the plans have been out there in the public, obviously the planning application process as well, and as the report also mentions, the board is on the ground and the advisory board, and the plans within the senior committee now have not changed the results of the last year, but of course the plans are very upset.
People tell them they don't want it, so it comes to that
difficult position in the order of the site, I think. That's what we're asking the city to do.
Okay. So Mark, apparently you were speaking on behalf of the council, right?
Yeah, well, I was. So my role as the Institute of Parks is to chair the campaign, and also I'm chairing the advisory board since that we started on the So quite clear as well, can you add on to that site as well? If you wanted to make it bigger, if you thought to yourself, we're getting more visitors than what we thought, could we add a bit on, you can do that. So I don't know why the community can be happy with that sort of thing. I know my review board, maybe we're getting something like that. So okay.
Yeah, a couple more K, Morris.
Yeah,
thanks.
Thanks, Mark.
First of all, apologies, I think I'm going to go over some very similar familiar ground. Thank you very much. I'd like to thank the officers for the information and the explanation that have been given to us before today's meeting and during this afternoon. It has made a huge difference to me. I too am very interested in the consultation and the claims about that. I, like everybody else in this room, have received emails from people, but actually quite a small number of people, a couple of people, who've been making their views clear very emphatically. I am interested in knowing how the other people in the community have been expressing their views here. What is the general feeling, in other words, amongst people in the community, people who will be affected by this, and who will use this centre, this building. And I'm still a bit confused, apologies for this, Grant, about the advisory board and the forum. The designs were agreed by the advisory board. I've written down design board, but it's advisory board. The designs were agreed by the advisory board.
That's sure. Yeah.
Did they have to be agreed by the forum as well? And if so, were they? And how is each of these bodies composed? Who, in other words, who's actually on these boards? You refer to community groups, etc. Who are the people who are actually there, and how are they checked? The advisory board agreed the designs. When did that happen, and how was that chaired? Who was the chair at that point? And I'm also interested in the design of the building. Incidentally, I quite like the design of this building. I can't understand why a couple of people are so opposed to it. I think it's interesting. It is, I think it was
They must have told us about the size of the building. It's robust. It's obviously a permanent building. It's probably a permanent building. But it also has what is, for me, a really interesting modular aspect. And correct me if I got that wrong, which could ensure an invaluable level of flexibility so that an additional building could be added in future, so that the additional use made of the building could be even more interesting. So I'd be really grateful if you could tell me if I've got that right, and maybe a bit more information in more technical terms than I have used.
Okay, there's any comments in those two contributions? Can I come back with the response?
I need that answer.
Yeah.
So, can I come in here? Just very quickly, because I think I'm going to cut through some of this stuff. The meeting on the fifth, so the advisory board is made up of representatives of local community councils, and at the forum, and there's also representatives of the local committee. So, there's local councillors on board on that as well. One of the representatives on the is a representative of the forum. That member was present on the 20th of January. The role of those representatives is then to feed back from the advisory group back into the community groups and take any signals to the community with regards to if we've got any issues. So
So the design document that went on the 20th of January, here she went back to the Planet Forum after the 20th of January last year. This is the big issue that we've got here. It's not that where we are with the design, it's a length of time that it's taken that community group to come back. Because the first I became aware that anyone in the community had an issue with regards to the design of the building was a letter I sent you 5 times at the end of October. So that's 8 months after the meeting in the Planet Forum signing off meeting of the advisory board signing off the design. So that for me that's a bit I'm concerned about is how long the fight in that length of time.
Okay, I mean I think that clarify some of the issues. The outstanding question is still that there was the accusation that no official turned up of one of the public meetings. Can we answer that?
Yes, there were two public meetings. As I mentioned in the report, there was lots of representation. The first, the Metropolitan Planners Association, and I agreed to set a smaller group of representatives from the first public meeting to sit down with council officers. My staff and Ray and his staff going through their concerns about the design in some detail and make that meeting took place about 10 days later. There was a second voting meeting to which I was certainly invited, one of my colleagues practically in touch with him, very short notice of him, due to the sort of pride commitment I have in sports partnership manager. So that was unfortunate, that was just the way it worked. Equally, I think there was a sense that I'm not too sure, we weren't too sure at that point, what we reacted to the debate. You know, being the first meeting, we spent something like 3 hours with the representatives of the group, meeting between 200 and 300 issues concerned by the media. And those, when we got to the issue, we couldn't get any of the short notice. And secondly, all the information that was required by the group was there, and they were able to make decisions as to whether they wanted to support the project.
Can I just hold there? I'm conscious this is going on and we'll go on some considerable time within kind of 5 minutes of the canteen shutting. I'm in your hands as to whether we press on or whether short break. Press on. Okay. I have a number of people.
I need to go back in the consultation to keep myself out here. I've asked this question. Now, I've dealt with consultations. Especially within the health service, I would never go to a meeting without an official of a change in something.
Andrew, that's no question. There's a number of other people. You've been in once. Can we give other people a chance that they might answer your questions as well? But Dave Dempsey.
Chair, trying to navigate your way through the noise and falsehoods surrounding this, and as far as I can see, there are strands to this whole business. There's the business of consultation and interaction with the public, over which there's contention, can't say. There's the provision of a new visitor centre, about which there's contention, can't say. And there's the golf and football pavilion. Am I right in thinking that that is not a source of the public?
That
was
pretty much
agreed,
is that correct?
That is
correct.
Thank you.
Leslie.
I'm going to ask for clarification on a number of things. Go back to the consultation then. I guess trying to also pick up on whose responsibility to do what. So if I read this correctly, we have an advisory committee which comprises members from community councils and local councillors and school, RAG and Police Scotland. We have therefore representatives who go back to their community councils post those meetings. So I suppose my question is, what updates did the respective community councils get from the advisory group post that meeting in January, and what actions were discussed and limited as a result of that? And who is on the, I guess what that suggests is there are people on the advisory council who are also on the community council. So who's also on the minority forum? And are they some of the same people who are on the advisory committee and on the community council? And I guess my question would be for the folks in the back. They've clearly got an interest in our filming. So are you? Do you sit on any of these?
I sit on the community council.
We'll go here and question the public gallery.
Well, I guess I'm just trying to understand.
Community council, which was never informed.
So what I'm trying to understand is, what was the chain of expectation of communication? So when we talk about, clearly there should have been more, I think we all recognise there should have been pick-up and consultation. But clearly, by having representatives go along to all of these events, information was known. The second point I want to touch on is the planning. So the weekly list, and everyone sitting out here gets the weekly list. And in my experience in my community councils, if anyone ever got the weekly list, they'd be filling up asking why. But notwithstanding that, errors can happen, you miss an email, people are busy, and I get that. But clearly, again, that weekly list is a pre-programmed thing, it just goes out. So even if that was missed, and we assume that it was, it was then on display in the park for 5 months. So my question, if it was on display in the park for 5 months, loads of people over that summertime surely must have seen those plans and must have thought either that, yeah, I like that, or no, I don't like that, or I wonder how I can find out more about that. Because I understand in the park, having visited the park, it was there for people to view and comment on. And my understanding is that no objections were there for the scene. So my question really comes back to, why have we waited till October when the plans were originally approved in the January? Because there is a bit here which is, we've also had information sent to us which has been responded to by the officer, which basically has set out a position which has been proven, I think, by some of the other information not to be accurate. So as a member having to look at this, I just want to understand the full scheme of who is supposed to do what happened and why, and what happened when it didn't.
I think there's still confusion on some of the previous questions about this, and I think Leslie's clarifying that. Can you, before that, take other people to want to have another go at clarifying those kind of points, please?
Are we not allowed to state?
No.
Sorry.
I thought you'd come back to the report and try to set out the conclusion of the order. So the meeting of the advisory board on the 20th of January last year was pretty, that's the green light. We had a process of discussion going on many months before that, probably years actually, but a couple of years before that, originally proposed to be the SCCT proposition, which wasn't delivered to the authority. The point we made about changing forces and looking at the internal design of the services. That principle was agreed by the advisory board back in July 2015. That one was consented, if you like, to go away through property to develop the design plans that we're seeing today. Those design plans in detail came back to the advisory board on the 20th of January last year and were endorsed. That's then for us to take that forward and to start to deliver the money. And it gets a little more complicated after that, because at some point in whatever, at some point in April, my terms of introduction, we took the view that the better value of delivering two projects with one contract and two projects separately. There's also the piece of that where they're consistent design, essentially across the whole board of the year, but they're not too far away from each other in the park. So the green light, January last year, we're then moving forward with property to finalise the designs and follow the whole process in terms of getting the planning application in, which we will touch on in the library, and obviously then seeking to deal with the tender and the contract period as soon as practically possible. So I think from the council point of view and the trust point of view, the meeting in January last year is significant because that's the green light that we're moving forward. Parallel to that, we have some of the reports for ourselves and the council convention. There was various information from the public domain that was on display, there was extensive coverage in the media, that was published. was to till late summer of the water. There was no notification from the farm or if there was any dissent to what we were trying to do in the park in the entrance. So that's in a nutshell the situation we were in. So very light out to the full system to go to move that forward. On the 7th, my intro in the spring, the agreement with the Trust and the Gulf Trust.
Consultation process is robust when we're faced with all of these comments claiming that it wasn't.
Okay, I've got Brian Poole.
By the consultation seems to have taken place at the
I can't see a major problem with the consultation. I take the point that Councillor Simon and others have made about receiving a letter, receiving a couple of emails, one which is actually, which was comprehensively, I suppose, discounted by the response from the officer. So I don't think we can take that particular,
we keep at this stage, Brian, to rule the question.
Oh, sorry. Mm-hmm. So I'm not clear, well, I'll tell you about the question for our officer then, because I'm not clear at all at this stage why this has been resisted, because the consultation seems to be I'm looking for pressure. If people are going to oppose this here, I would want to know why has it been resisted and what should have been done that's not been done. And that's not clear to me at this stage.
I think you'll maybe get that in part of the debate afterwards, but I mean there are a number of questions. There's a number of questions there from Fife and on the 83,000 if you want to respond to.
I don't think the 83,000 is getting very well. Absolutely lost that. You take the letter of the letter of law in terms of the issue that's actually been offered grounds today, depending on what to do on that. We have opened further dialogue with us on the issue earlier, that will find a decision today in terms of where we're going with the project, sit down with it again. There is a significant risk of a rule, Mr. Money, equally, there's hopefully a chance that they will see benefits in terms of the investment of the project. Okay, the time of the research that they may have been with that and allow the but that same as a source of we'll have that large consumer access. So just one supplementary question.
Very quick.
So if this was delayed and I have to go to a retender, and it's a subjective question to you guys, but presumably there would be the concern that the tender will come in at a higher price. Is that not what is that your concern? And what's the evidence for that in the case?
The retender that I think would be more expensive because the consent to own these are only $2 getting built on one side. That's where there's a same compound on one side each end. Facilities, pilots, so all machine and cost of the building. Also, the order of deadline things are the order of system. We're going to be a financial impact there, we're going to be a small building. So it's good there at all, we'll be a financial impact.
First of all, you've given us a qualifying or be honest, an estimate, a range for that may be.
I've said that I think we're talking about £100,000.
Okay, we've got David Alexander.
Yes, got a question. We heard the school councillors on the advisory group back in 2013. Were they cross party? Did they represent all the parties representing them? Only were okay if they were there. So, why was that not the case then? The way the committee actually voted.
So, what happened was. The chair got a position, and then there was a position at three other positions, and we divided up into three wards. So the three wards were made up of seven of the parts.
So there were all the other councillors, plus the chair.
Plus the chair, yeah.
Just come back. I think there were points that Faye raised that haven't been answered. But in fact,
the was no comments,
oh, yeah.
The authority, and again, further a bit of consultation.
Sorry, just a comment on that. I take a point about the legal consultations in terms of my application, or the my experience, which is that people reject the final license to place comments on my application with the support. But Bob Wayne has said in the report with the high application, seek no comments whatsoever.
Mark, could you respond to the issue about what authority you had and the scope of the commitment you effective in that context.
Yeah, I mean, in the meeting, it was quite clear that the room, the number of people in that meeting were very clear that the majority in that room obviously certainly didn't want them to go ahead, and it came to that meeting with a specific agenda to stop that project, because they wanted to stop it going ahead, because it, for whatever reason, they didn't like it. I think there was a number of issues that come up, most of them have been kind of squashed by the officers, but for me, in that meeting, what I said was, if there was effectively told by the public, didn't want it to go ahead, I simply say that we wouldn't want it to go ahead with it. The problem that we've got is, it's quite clear that the public have fairly directed on it, and on that case, for about a year, we wouldn't have made the decision.
Thanks. I'm going to stand it up. I'm sure we're going to stand up today. I'd just like a bit of clarity on the public display aspect. In section 211, it mentions that the plans, elevations, etc., are put on display for a period of 4 months in the visitor centre. Now, I've been told by one of the people who've got in touch with me that they have concerns about whereabouts within that visitor centre and the display was displayed. So I'd like clarity of where exactly they were on display. Is this a place where the public actually pass by on a regular basis? And what the officer's definition of public display is? And this is a sort of a process thing. I think we need to take cognizance of this about any display of public plans, if it is actually public, that people know about it, they know where it is, they're pointed in the right direction. And then we build into that the fact that we're also being told that it's possible that the Benefit Centre weren't given copies to show people if they did inquire. So that's another concern from that process in perspective. Like, did we get that part of this process right?
Okay.
This is for to actually get officers in this council to give me the reasons for this. I'll read out this paragraph from Willie Farr. There have been two public meetings in the community with standing room only, who expressed a concern about the proposed development. When it was announced that no council official would come out and meet the community to discuss a solution, this gave rise to people's anger that they are being ignored by the council. What I want to know for officers, although you could not attend on these evenings, did you facilitate at any point to say to the whoever to say, by the way, can we meet you at some other time? Because we can't meet on these nights because we've got prior engagements. Because that then would say to me quite clearly that anybody could get another meeting, I'd have to go and meet this officer. But if you could tell me that you could say, well, what we did was we offered another meet, did that happen? Did it not happen?
Just to rewind to what I said earlier, Andrew, between the two public meetings, there was a 3-hour plus meeting with officers and representatives from the committee to walk through in significant detail the designs that you see, the issues that are of concern. At the end of that meeting, in black and white, we offered if there's any information, if there's information, anything you're not clear about, come back to us and we're happy to sit down and have another meeting in a short period of time between the first meeting and the second public meeting. That problem wasn't so taken up. I think we've always been
so nobody came back from
the examine the process whereby the proposal for the new visitor centre and integrated clubhouse changes for those were developed with a view to learning lessons for future projects. Can I have a seconder for that? Okay. Are there any amendments to that?
Yeah, well,
I think you wonder about the second factor that isn't part of this.
We are specifically in the
question. The original looks a local Meadows as a local Meadows.
Microphone.
Sorry. The original looks a local Meadows as a potential venue for the cycle circuit, but it was ruled out because of wind conditions.
Right. Okay. Just let's know.
This is when they play in this one.
Yes, the contract, the tender prices are backing, and we currently haven't awarded the contract yet. There's a shortfall on funding between the costs and the federal budget, and we're having discussions internally about how best to try and bridge that gap, and also how to award the contract to such time as that funding out of the group. But it also is worth pointing out that £600,000 worth of certain funding relating on this particular project, this particular location, £300,000 from the Sports Facilities Fund at Southwest Sports Scotland, £300,000 we agreed to earlier, also coming from the Scottish Generation Capital Development Fund. So there's a significant risk in terms of losing that fund, which obviously wouldn't be necessary to just shut it to start the right strategy approach.
For that basis, Chair, and Lord Town will be delegated to the position of the contract is not in the hold here. We will be confident to bring that into this discussion.
Okay, to clarify that, Dave, did you have something separate?
Yes, Chair, although I'm wondering how separate it is. What I'm going to propose was that we need to go ahead with the contract for the golf control facility and prepare the visitor centre and the process.
We've got a seconder for that. Okay. Right, we have three things on the table. I open up for any contributions. Or do we want to just go over the vote?
I don't think we should use no real vote. This has been a controversial issue, to say the least. And the explanations that were put today at the committee, you can draw several conclusions from it. There's been ample opportunity for not months, but actually well over a year plus, of representations to be made about the project. The commitment was given by the Labour administration to make this investment. I know it wasn't in the SNP budget, and they didn't agree with our budget. And there's certainly a question mark when laughing about whether this is just a black hole stunt, to be honest.
Rubbish.
That aside, it could be. You could draw your own conclusions. But the reality is, We're in the game of investment in Lochore Meadows. It's a five-wide opportunity to invest in Lochore Meadows. There's a development plan for it. It's all in place. And there is... I don't think in all the time I've been a councillor, it's a long, long time, if I ever interrupted somebody's making a contribution. I'd like to have the same thing for myself, if you don't mind. So, the things we've had to draw on are, was the public consultation relevant? There were opportunities for making representations there. Contributions came back from the community during, I think, the best part of a year? And all of these questions, you know, there has been nothing come back until October last year, which my father picking up from the conversation with him. That seems kind of bizarre to me. There have been a very late attempt by somebody to put a spanner in the works of this development. I read an email that came out and that went to all of us, that was making suggestions about, and this is probably what would start up a community actually, suggestions about value for money, suggestions about buildings being provided, and I think it was Highland Region, much cheaper way. The person that sent the thing out was decent enough to say he's not an expert, and when we got the replies back through property services to the suggestions that were being made about value for money, it was pretty obvious that he's not an expert. But the contribution that had been made like that was enough in my mind to stir up a community to make objections based on what were being presented to them as facts. What we've had now is facts presented to us by professional staff who have got a track record second to none in the whole of Scotland about delivering projects at schools, delivering projects like over in community centre, and they have got a track record to be proud of, and they were called into question, which I find objectionable. That would call into question just left me a wee bit offline a wee bit. Baby Johnson has presented to us the facts, and the old that's what property people do. And the facts are that we've got a proposal on the table to develop at Lochore Meadows, something which will be massively beneficial to the whole of Fife and probably wider, as people come to Lochore from all over the country. And I've got no doubts whatsoever that supporting this will be beneficial, not just to the local community, but to the wider community in Fife. And I certainly support the recommendation that David was moving. And I've got no problem. I quite agree with people having the opportunity to express different opinions. That's how life should be. You know, if you've got a different opinion on it, that's life, and that's fine. But we have to draw conclusions as councillors about the investments that we make and where we get value for money, and we take professional advice on that. And the professional advice I definitely take, and I think we move forward with a project that is going to have a terrific positive impact on the whole of Fife.
Andrew Roger.
Thank you, Chair. Just a question
to
what you said here today, and really, as I say, I came in with an open mind, but listening to officers, I'm convinced that the officers have done their utmost in this situation to do the right thing by this council. And also, to me, it's a really good story in a sense. We said earlier, just before that, about the Keynes. 20 odd years we've looked for something like this. And what we're hearing now just at the end as well is that if this business go ahead, there could be a problem with the risk that the money that's coming from other organisations to prop up this money. And quite clearly, I just feel that what's been presented here, I think it's a great design in a sense, and plus the fact is it could be added to it if there's a bit needs to be added to it, it could be added in the future. But to put all the suggestions on the table, well, let's don't go ahead, but let's think again, and then the money floats out the door again. I'm sorry, but the point is that I will be supporting this for the simple reasons that this is what Neil said as well. We've got officers here who know their job inside out, get us value for money in a sense, and as I say, I believe they've done the utmost within the community. I don't know if anybody's been playing games, I just don't know what's been happening there at all. But what I'm hearing from officers, they've done the most to put it there, ask to come back to people who want to put in their bit of contribution. So right through the game, as I say, we've tried to do the best. And plus the fact as well, as I say, this advisory group, where I think there's quite a few people sitting there from the community as well, I had no concerns about it, so quite clearly, if it was in my ear, I'd welcome this. So.
Thanks, Chair. What was it? Neil, if I interrupted him, but when you've been accused of something that's clearly not true, that's a kind of a knee-jerk reaction to respond. The situation that we've got in front of us is not just about the local community, it's important for all of us, because all of us will go to the clinics, we all use it, and I think I just want to shift the focus away from the minutiae, the details, the people who went to progress in the basic principles. Is it good enough for a room full of folk? I know we're elected representatives for our communities, but is it good enough for us to say, oh, we like that? Particularly in the face of not heard about ones and twos, contact your ass.
heard very clearly about groomsful of people opposed to this scheme. And I think, you know, if there are question marks about community involvement engagement within that, even if you say you tick the boxes of process that we've been through, there are clearly some concerns about commitments that have been given and whether they've been honoured now or not. And that is a disservice to all of us if we're making commitments that we cannot keep. And that's absolutely clear to me that mistakes have been made during this process, and that it's not been as transparent as we would like. I think it's a perfect opportunity not to press ahead with something that could be the wrong fit for this facility, because it is so important for all of us. It's really important to get it absolutely right. And if, because of however well-intended an engagement process the consultation was, if it's because of it was flawed in some way and that we didn't get the comments that we're now getting, then we need to take cognizance of that. We can't just say, well, no, you had your chance, we're not listening now. That's not good enough. I think that the suggestion from Councillor Bain about co-locating the cycle track has a very good adjacency with some of the other cycling activity that's being planned for the site. I think that should be given due diligence. I understand that the Great Craig site has concerns about its suitability for the cycle track anyway, so there are perhaps other issues that could be looked there. But I think fundamentally at the heart of this is we can't be perceived or be seen to be doing something to communities instead of with them. And that's fundamentally the key thing here, is there's a fundamental issue about the number of people who do not feel that they are being listened to, and I feel very uncomfortable about ignoring that. I think that there's an opportunity, there needs to be an opportunity, to step back from the process, reassess the situation, to look for a better fit and a better opportunity, because if we're going to one of the other points that's raised in the paper is about how we promote, but one of the challenges from the trust was that how the site is managed, how it's promoted and used. If we're not getting that bit right either, then the numbers of potential visitors could be much greater, and therefore it's even more important to get the facility right with all of that taken into consideration. But I think the final thing and the most important thing is a commitment was given to the community at a meeting that if they were not happy, that it would be paused, it would be stopped, and it wouldn't proceed until they were happy. That commitment, whoever made it, in whatever term, that commitment was given, and we've got a responsibility to take that into any consideration, and I think we have to honour that commitment, absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay, Linda.
Chair, thank you. In terms of the Meadows, there's a number of things that concern me. I have representatives of the community that need actually advise me, so the community have been involved in this process already, and they voted in favour of this to go out a year ago. There's issues, and I have to say, the principal assembly that issued the display in the Rand Centre, again, the plans wasn't as good as it should have been. However, anybody that went into and is familiar with the meeting centre, you've got an entrance hall, you can't miss, you couldn't miss the actual design. And I've done it late at least 30 times. And we certainly haven't had plans, but I have to comment on it because actually I didn't have any objection. Now, I know loads of people that go in there, I don't know, that walk there every day, that cycle there every day, that run there every day, that are happy with that, but they didn't put any comments up. And actually, we're in danger of it. If we accept what Neil's proposing, Neil Handy has, that we'll never get another family thing through again because we'll always be calling it back. The reality is that information and plans were shown for months and there were no objections, absolutely none. And I have to say, as a councillor, because I was asked by somebody on the website about how many objections I had received. Now, I received a correspondence from Mr. Kinnaird, which has been utterly refuted by the officers we have, and I have to say that I have taken very strong recognizance of the information that was actually presented in there, because it's factual, the information is there, and everybody is around the table must have received that, and I don't think we could have what he said. I received yesterday one objection from a lady in Cardi Den, and on Friday last week I received an objection from a lady in Berardi. All the other discussions I've had with the constituents, whether it be on phone, through the subsidies, have been positive. There was no objections raised at the Community Council either. What the Community Council wanted, both it's only discussed at the Community Council, was a support for campaign for facilities which are suitable for the location. And I believe that they are suitable, given that they are actually modular and can be added to when we have money. And we have to come up with the money that we've got. It would be wonderful to have an extra £1 million to add on to that. We put £1 million aside. I think certainly in terms of the golfing community and the football community, they are absolutely in favour of this going ahead. So I personally think that we should be going ahead with it as a user of the whole Meadows, where I go very often and I certainly take a handshot from the twice at the weekends.
Thank you, Chair. But I asked confirmed earlier there are three strands to this. There is the consultation and getting all the action of the project, which is not the customer, and the great objection is that it doesn't go that. There's the golf football element, which again, there's getting great potential, but it doesn't go into that stage. And there's this visitor sector, and the question for me is whether the public concern and disquiet about this is sufficient, and that it should be paused and be examined and eventually considered with at a greater cost than what it would be. And so the question is the balance between the concern and the benefits of getting on with it and saving good money. And it's difficult for me as an outsider to gauge the situation in our key area. However, I have in front of me, as we all do, an opinion from someone who clearly is an authority in our key area in the shape of Willie Clark. My meaning of his letter is that he agrees with me that this should not go ahead in the present form. It should take stock of the visitor centre element and come to an answer that has the vice principal of the community must be behind the event to vote.
Chair, thank you. My sole concern, unfortunately, we've gotten to this point. We haven't actually heard what the Fife Coastal Countryside Trust are recommending, or by inference are they recommending approval. I'm conscious that Councillor Laird is a member of that group, but Laird's interest in it, and as I get put in the main act responsibility. I'm still sad that if it had been one of my community councils, I would have made it my business to have gone back to the community council and said, I am the leader of this. I don't know the way in which councils operate in your area, but it would appear that that didn't happen. But for whatever reason, thank you, as I said, yes, Lochore, where I was elected. I remain concerned, I think, that we have a split community. We seem to have a lot of people who are not happy with this, and I would prefer that there is further discussion about it. My point is, I don't know enough about the cycle path proposal, so I have no idea whether that is something that I could support. But as David has just said, we've got a letter from Woody Clark saying that we should hold on. And also we've had a letter from Councillor Mary Lockhart who feels that we should we should manage this. So I think get on with the football and the golf, but I personally think we should take more time on the busy sector.
You just kind of echo those sentiments. You were accused of this being a party political stunt. I'm not sure which party is pulling the stunt when you've got representation from around the Labour group saying that this should be halted. We're told that we shouldn't be objecting to this now, the community shouldn't be objecting to this now, because it was signed off by a board made up of various different local organisations, as well as three ward councillors and the chair of the area committee. Well, the chair of the area committee at the time has also written to us saying, it appears that the present development does not have the support of the community. It isn't far-seeing enough to realise that the money being invested does not solve the problems at present. We're being told by councillors and former councillors in this area that it does not represent the wishes of the community. So I really do feel that I could support a proposal that ignores that.
Alternate.
Thanks, Chair. It's going along on my way in. I'm not being based on. I'm out with the festivals outside, and I've got two places to drop you on, and I've dropped you on one. I'm out with the festivals outside for a few things. I don't cure the new game. Anyway, the point I make is that I wouldn't suggest that it was a political group that I met outside. They have concerns, and I think it's always important to listen to these. Sometimes they're helped along the way by political reasons, and that's fine too, because it happens everywhere. All campaigns are a bit of that. However, what I would like to do is just take a couple of moments of going through the process. We've had consultation. We've had the chair who's now changed his mind, the chair at the time, a national treasurer, who's changed his mind about what he thinks about this, but he was on the board who passed it last January. And for me, I find that quite difficult to sort of find my way around. But let's leave that aside. We've got some in the community unhappy with it, and we've got some in the community who felt it necessary to set up their own Facebook page saying positive things about me. So for me, this isn't a drag, you know, it's just a flipping mess. But the consultation element of it, is it wouldn't matter what consultation you did, because there's always going to be people say, oh, I never knew. We have a thing in our local plan for 900 houses or the strategic land use thing, and nobody noticed until well after the end. So I don't know how we get it better other than practically ranking to everyone. For me, the costs are the issue. I'm listening carefully to all things, and it's not great, but £150,000 to restore the asbestos invasion and this stuff that we put through the back of the dump centre, just nod from the inland right back. Yeah. 150, 100,000 on the cost to do this in two halves, apart from disruption, roughly, 280, and £83,000 off, you're not getting it anymore. And if we can take the 83 out, just 150,000 extra cost, we're trying to get the best value for the community. So that's what we should be focusing on. I think this centre for those who are not properly, it's just a centre. I've seen loads of them, it's like one of them, I can't be wrong. But there are lots of them around the place. So the design part's not important to me. The additional costs bother me. I don't see the point in just sort of stopping to add on £250,000 of costs if we can deliver a centre that will probably become much more once we're using it. It's better to have the centre up on the ground than doing the job. So for me, I can't really in any sort of conscience say, let's stop spending like £250,000 before we start with the cost of more money to be found. I'm not inclined to conflate it with any other project, and I think it's scurrilous to do so. And it is. From that point, for me, David's point is about it. We should push the button on this and we should get on with it and try and find a way to bring people together to use the centre for what it's for. And that's the bit we're going to have to try and deal with something with. It's not being perfect, of course it's not. Nothing to do with it, but the club, the football, the 50 people, of course they're happy, they're getting the change in facilities. So there's no, these are non-contentious. We just need to get together, get in a room, let's put the consultation failures, if that's how we view them, to the side and see how we're going to make this work. So for me, I think we do that, and we have to learn from it, because there's been too many of these where we said, you know what, we've kind of consulted, kind of got it right, but we're getting better at each time. We're getting better at it. A lot better than some of the consultations I've had to put up in the past. So we're getting better, but in this case, I think that to wait is just the wrong choice. It's the wrong motivation. It's not supposed to be.
Okay. can do with Alexander.
Have you got another battery?
Yeah. I feel like I'm but don't think my have had a few really as a post something that you guys can be great for them. That doesn't make sense, does it? In a sense, you see that all these guys have been wound up. Doesn't make sense. Communities don't happen like that. So let's accept, I think we're accepting now, there's opposition to this. To start off with, there's no really it. But now we know what they're supposed to be.
Can we let David?
Right. You can't make folk come and do this unless they want to, unless they feel strong with their own community. That just can't happen. The idea that we get it wrong maybe in terms of time, and if we spend that money, spend a couple of million, rather than doing it right, doesn't make sense to me either. You do it right. Because if you get it wrong, you spend it wrong, you never recover. You have to leave enough financial capital disasters in this council to tell us that, by the way. We start doing it right. And the community are with us when we do it right. It's as simple as that. I don't think we can go in its present state. It doesn't make any sense. It really doesn't.
Okay, Mark.
Thanks, Chair. I mean, I've got a few comments to make, but I could just start by thanking the officers. There's been a lot more heat around this than light over the last couple of months, and to be quite honest, if they put up with some sort of allegations, which quite frankly I just always said to me, anybody coming up to their work, and I think the cowardly thing is that a lot of these people who are making these allegations, they didn't make up citing all the facts, and I think that's a real issue for me with regards to how certain members, or very, very few members within the community, have conducted themselves during this process. Consultation. This document is a document that went to the advisory board on the 20th of January. You can see the design there. Basically the same thing as what we've been saying today. That meeting was attended by a number of reps, including Mr. John Clark at the time, and the representative from the Barry Corner. At the minute of that meeting, one of the last paragraphs, the advisory board agreed that they are happy with the proposed design and we are happy for work to continue on the project as planned. That for me says a lot about where we were in January last year, and the consultation noted at that point raised any concern about the consultation, for the lack of consultation that was going on at that time. Now, I believe that there was fairness for the gas consultation. I think we could have done much more for the gas consultation, but we are where we are.
No.
However, I think what has surprised me more today is the SNP's amendment to complete the second sector with the visitor centre. And let me just but we stuck to our guns because we believe that along with the investment that we've put into the local Meadows around mountain bike trails, and I think there's a bit of confusion around bike trails like something in the bike trail, they are completely different. Okay, so the investment of 130,000 in the mountain bike trails that have gone there. And alongside that, having a facility for road bikes and the cycle circuit up in the was seen as by Cycle Scotland and Sports Scotland as being a real good. So the site identified by Sports Scotland with regards to the site, along with us, so Sports Scotland and Scottish Cycling have been sitting in the room with regards to the cycle circuit for probably around 2 years now. And every one of those meetings we took that and for us now to go back to that at this stage and suggest that actually we're going to move it somewhere else is probably bonkers. It's probably the worst thing I've heard in the last 10 years of the councillor. I don't understand how some councillors could even come up with that as a possible proposal. They seem to know nothing about what's going on in the community, quite frankly.
Right, one minute,
Mark. Okay, so for me, let's go back. We made a commitment that, for me, we needed to know that the public were completely against it. What's
published some of that, it's a misinformation that's gone into it, because the many people I speak to that are against it have got completely misinformed information, and that's because we've sat down, the officers have sat down in this council in a room, explained to people the processes that are going through for procurement, for cost, the design process, and all the details that they've asked, answered all those questions. The same people have walked out of the room and told a completely different story. Okay? And that has misinformed much of the community. So it makes it very, very difficult for us to come to an opinion that somebody can make 50% of the community are saying yes and 50% of the community are no. As far as I'm concerned, I go back to the manifesto place, make a little demonstration in 2012, then we would invest in the park, and that's what we're going to do.
Thanks, Brian. Brian Poole, the last one I've got in the game.
Thank you. I guess Andrew prepared to spend more of this kind of stuff between now and where Labour members, like, we'll see the SNP members for the politics of this, and I guess the SNP members will see a member of the Labour for the politics of this. I don't think that I'm actually quite sure. For my part, what I would say is if this is so important to stop, then it should have been brought forward last year. I just think to bring it forward in the 4 months leading up to the election, for me, maybe I'm cynical. Well, I am cynical. It's just too much of a coincidence for me to drop forward at this stage. The cycle circuit, I'm just amazed that we could actually think of jeopardising that at this stage. I think the reputation of night to not so strong in the hearing on that issue would be dead. For my part, I'm trying to figure out what might happen, if this was delayed. The cost would undoubtedly increase, that's a certainty to put that from the officers. Quite probably, given the computer work that's going on in the current centre, would we get a better design at the end of the moment? We may get a different design and get more money. But whether that would be a better design is really a great subject. As like I said earlier, I think we can try to find out what's wrong with the design. I think officers have said themselves that the consultation could have been better, and that is kind of what gives that option to look at that is in the motion, given that's going to go to scrutiny, I think. So for me, the only delay result in anything better, and I just feel like I can't see how it can unless we really substantially increase the budget and given the current budget situation, that's just impossible. So we're kidding ourselves on. So the likelihood we would delay this, we would go out of consultation and we would come back and we would do exactly the same thing. So accepting that there's arguments for and against, and I accept the right and the passion that some of that local community are, but we don't know what the local community is against, so we're going to ask that local community for their view, and I'm sure there'll be some people who will be equally passionate for it. So given the pros and cons, I think the risks for delaying this are greater than for
I understand it, case the lead, you are a member of the CPD.
Size that has been an issue. We've heard that because of the more efficient and the better use of public space and the wasted space in the current building and the non-accessible space, it is virtually equivalent. In terms of the costs, we've heard that it has been tendered robustly and it is value for money, and that has been confirmed by our officers. We've heard that separating the contracts or delaying the contracts will incur significant additional costs and won't get us any further forward in terms of what we're able to deliver. In fact, it would jeopardise, unless there was significant additional funding going in, it would jeopardise our ability to provide any new centre there. In terms of the cycle circuit, again, like Mark, I think that is a totally inappropriate suggestion to complete the two and to suggest that we don't go ahead with that. I've been present at a number of very significant consultation events on that, and that has 100% support from the cycling community across Fife and will be a major asset to our tourism offer going forward. And to suggest we stop with that and lose £600,000 of external funding to it is just not acceptable to me. We've heard a number of interventions from Willie Clark. I've read Willie's letter and I know his view on the matter. But what is important and comes across in Willie's letter to him is there needs to be visitor centre there in that park over the summer period. And the only way, sure way, of actually delivering that is to go forward with provision of the new centre. I'll also talk to Mary Rocker, and Mary's view, she has been taking soundings in her local community. Her view is the community is split almost down the middle. Her judgment is that because of that split, she would prefer it to be paused. My judgment is that split, we need to go ahead. And once the thing is in place, I think people will see the benefits of it. And that is the bottom line, is this is a significant £1.8 million investment which will benefit the Lochore Meadows and the surrounding communities. And on that basis, I think throwing it up in the air and questioning whether or not we are able to deliver something in future is the wrong thing to do. So I'll be pressing ahead to propose that we do go ahead on the basis of what I've suggested. So I'm going to propose the vote.
Motion by yourself, seconded by Councillor Erskine, is that in terms of the recommendations, ask to move the change of the management arrangements and the formally award contract for the proposed new visitor centre and the integrated golf club change the pavilion.
also understand what it is again, that this is the decision not the subject to call it, but that separately the issue being referred to scrutiny to let license. The first amendment by Councillor Bain, second by Councillor Udall, is to award the contract only for the golf football facility, and to agree that the visitor centre be put on hold, and also agree that the cycle track project for Glen Craig be put on hold pending the outcome of further discussions on this issue.
The current visitor centre be reinstated with the new development put on hold pending the consultation.
Thanks. Second amendment by Councillor Bennett, the second Councillor here, is to award the contract for golf and football facility to refer the issue of the visitor centre and the whole process to the scrutiny committee for further consideration. The votes for Councillor Bennett's amendment first. Could I have votes for the First Amendment, which is Councillor Baines, please? And could I have votes for the motion, please, which the chairs? Votes are motion 10, First Amendment 6, Second Amendment 2, and as the motion has the overall majority, it is carried.
Thanks for the